Hello everyone, my name is Clemens Laska. I'm a PhD student in the group of Wolfgang Lechner here in Innsbruck. And today I will present some work we did in collaboration with Lukas Sieberer and Wolfgang Lechner about how to use Hopfield networks for quantum state preparation. So the task we have in mind is the following. We want to take a list of classical input states, which we want to feed into some device which is able to create a coherent superposition out of these classical input states. Okay, an optimal device would be able to take all of these 2 to the power of n input state and produce a coherent superposition out of that. That would be something which is, for example, a QRAM, but the problem there is that it comes with exponential cost in resources. So what we thought about is, can we do actually something simpler for near-term devices, which may be still useful? So making something simpler also means that we have to impose some restrictions, which in our case would be like that we want to restrict ourselves to polynomial input, which should be transformed, however, with polynomial resources. And for now, we also would like to restrict ourselves to programming only the squared amplitudes here. Okay, so far so good, but if one has all these nice experiments in quantum simulation in mind where they use Hamiltonian dynamics for a lot of things, so why don't we use adiabatic quantum computation for this kind of task? What we have in mind is simply a linear switching schedule between a driver and a problem Hamiltonian here. And this splits for us into a 2-step protocol, where the first step is that we have to design actually the problem Hamiltonian. So what do we mean by that? We want to have the classical input as the degenerate ground states of this problem Hamiltonian here. Okay, and the second step would be that we want to generate these superpositions via quantum annealing in this degenerate ground state manifold over here. Okay, but both of these steps, of course, come with their own challenges. So the challenge in step one is that we want to realize such a Hamiltonian with only few body interaction terms, which is very relevant for implementation. For example, if you would take this projector here and decompose it into sigma set interactions, it turns out that one would need, in general, n local interactions, which is very unphysical. Okay, so how to actually design these ground states we described in this paper here, where we used Hopfield networks. Okay, the challenge in step two actually is how do we access these quantum paths leading to a certain superposition? And the solution to that is presented in this paper here, where we use a lattice gauge model and lattice gauge degrees of freedom in order to program those amplitudes. First, I will start now with an overview on step two, and then I will focus on the more recent work of step one. Okay. Let me start out with a very related problem, the problem of fair sampling. What is fair sampling? Fair sampling is, in general, the ability of an algorithm to find all cost function minimizing states with similar probability. So what about the conventional adiabatic algorithm like this? So this was investigated in these two papers here, where they looked at the sampling properties of quadratic problem Hamiltonian with known degeneracies under different driver densities here. What they found is if you only take a single X driver, the amplitudes or the probabilities to find a certain ground state are very biased. So if you increase the driver, it becomes slightly better, but still very biased. So the main conclusion from their papers was that conventional quantum annealing with non-sufficiently dense drivers is not a fair sampling method. What I mean by non-sufficiently dense drivers is that the driver has to be at the order of the maximal Hamming distance connecting 2 of these ground states. Okay, so one can try to understand this a bit better in perturbation theory. If one looks at this transverse icing model with a single X driver, for example, one can put up some Schiefer-Wolf perturbation theory, because at the end, or towards the end of the sweep, the driver is actually a perturbation to the problem. Okay, one, if one wants to do so, one has to define a low-energy manifold and its complement, and if one does the math, what comes out is an effective description which really lives on this low-energy manifold defined here. What one can immediately see here is that the diagonals vanish with the power of minus 2, and the off-diagonals vanish with the Hamming distance in the exponent. So what one really sees now is that the matrix elements here are determined by the problem, and there are no problem-independent tuning knobs to access these matrix elements. So, and now one can also understand why putting up higher-order drivers helps, because increasing the driver density here decreases this exponent here, because this exponent simply reflects the order of perturbation theory necessary to connect two ground states with actually this Hamming distance. Okay, so far so good, but adding higher order driver terms is clearly not the solution for implementation in hardware. So is there a way to still program superpositions with single X drivers? And therefore, we clearly need, first of all, access to these matrix elements. The strategy we have in mind is to translate this original problem into a lattice gauge encoding and use the gauge degrees of freedom. Okay, the lattice gauge encoding we have in mind is the so-called LHZ encoding, which works like this. You take the original logical problem, which is an all-to-all connected Ising spin glass, and then you take a parity encoding, which maps this problem into a physical problem, where the former two-party interactions are mapped to local fields on physical qubits. However, you increase the Hilbert space, of course, by doing this mapping from 2 to the power of n to 2 to the power of n squared. So you get, in the physical problem, unphysical states which are, have no correspondence in the logical problem. So what you have to do is to energetically penalize these unphysical states, and this can be done with these local four-body terms here. The nice thing about this architecture is that it only comprises local interactions, which makes it kind of interesting for implementation in actual hardware. Okay, let me shortly emphasize what we mean by gauge degrees of freedom. As I told you before, the low energy spectrum encodes the logical problem here, and the constraints separate this from the unphysical states via these constraint terms here. So, however, this low energy subspace is invariant under variation of these individual constraint prefactors, so that's why we call them gauge variables. Okay, so what happens now with our effective description when we change from the logical problem into the LHZ problem? Clearly, we get access to the matrix elements here because they become suddenly gauge dependent. So what we introduce here is we have some problem independent tuning knobs for tuning the probabilities in the end. However, this exponent with the Hamming distance is still here, so what one has still to do is to find a sweet spot where these tunable matrix elements are impactful. Okay, so for this, let's have a look at the sweep once more. So since we are annealing into a degenerate ground state manifold, this sweep can never be fully adiabatic. So it's more an adiabatic-diabatic process. What I mean by that is that up from zero up to some freeze-out point, the dynamics is fully adiabatic, and then afterwards, the system evolves adiabatically. Okay, the nice thing about this freeze-out point is that at this freeze-out point, afterwards, the probabilities of the lowest instantaneous eigenstate don't change anymore. So we have our sweet spot, to program the amplitudes of our superposition. Okay, so far so good. Now I show you a picture that this actually works for this small example. I plotted here the overlap between the three lowest lying instantaneous eigenstates with the full time evolution. And what one can see here clearly is that up to the freeze-out time, all the system evolves fully adiabatically, so everything is in the lowest instantaneous eigenstate. And afterwards, after like optimizing these constraints, one can really get here to probabilities of 1/3. Okay, but if you want to have all the details of the formulas, etc., I would reference to this paper here. So let me now switch to the second step of our protocol, namely the classical problem of the ground state design. As I said before, like our goal is to take a polynomial number of arbitrary bit strings and encode them in the ground states of a classical Ising Hamiltonian. Okay, as I said before, the naive approach would be I write down in a projector and decompose it into interactions, but one immediately sees that this is not a feasible thing due to the n local terms that appear. Okay, so what we really want is a low k local logical Hamiltonian like this, which has a relevance in implementation, and such that arbitrary data bit strings are approximately degenerate ground states. Here I plotted an example for a spectrum we want to have. Like here is a 10-spin system where 20 arbitrary configurations are actually encoded in the ground state. So with this figure, it also becomes immediately clear what is our figure of merit we want to optimize in the end, and that is this delta here, which is the energy bandwidth of the stored patterns over the separation to the pike. Okay. Storing patterns in the energy landscape of an Ising spin glass strongly resembles the notion of learning in Hopfield networks. So in the following, we will misuse kind of Hopfield networks in an unusual setting for ground state design. Okay, but what are Hopfield networks? Hopfield networks are all-to-all connected Ising spin glasses like this, where the interaction matrix elements are constructed via certain learning rules. The most prominent one is the so-called Hebbian learning rule, which is constructed like this. For the two local case, it's an inner product rule, where you have the sum over all the patterns you want to store, and you multiply the bit strings, the bit values of bit I and j. In the spin language, it looks like this, where the xi's are simply the eigenvalues of the sigma set operator. And if you want to construct, for example, the matrix element 2, 5, you can just multiply these two eigenvalues to get it. If you want to take a neural network perspective, this is kind of the model people thought at the beginning how computations may work in the brain. That's why this rule is often summarized as neurons that fire together, wire together. Okay. This construction can be easily generalized to higher order terms. For example, if I want to include a three-body interaction, I can construct this matrix element like really similar to before, which means that if I put up if I want to get this matrix element between 1, 2, and 5, I simply multiply these eigenvalues here. Okay, and this can go on for arbitrary up to n local, but as I said before, we want to restrict ourselves to low k local Hamiltonians. Okay, so far so good, but the Hopfield network construction only ensures that data bit strings are located at local energy minima with respect to the Hamming distance. Here I plotted an example for again 10 spins, 20 arbitrary patterns, and 2 and 3-body interaction. The color code here is the minimal Hamming distance to any of the stored patterns. So 0 means the pattern itself, 1 means Hamming distance 1, and so on. This is what in neural network community is called the basin of attraction. As you can see, this Hopfield construction poses a very nice Hamming distance dependent ordering onto the spectrum, which is actually the spacing of attraction. Okay, but what we want in the end is global energy minima. So what do we do? So we take now the Hopfield network as an ansatz for variational ground state design. So we want to do on top of the normal Hopfield construction some moves on individual patterns. For example, I could do relearning of the highest lying learned pattern and shift it downwards with that. This is simply, as I said, on top of the normal Hopfield thing, an individual relearning of this pattern. And as you can already infer, the second move is simply the opposite. I could also take the point of view to unlearn a lowest lying unwanted or bulk pattern, which are also often called spurious patterns, which would be this one. And then I unlearn it, which is the difference between re and unlearning is simply this sign change here in this matrix element construction. Okay, so now we have all the tools at hand for our optimization algorithm, so we can run some iterative stochastic optimization until desired delta is reached. So we start out from the collective Hopfield network and then do relearning and unlearning steps. What happens there, you can see now, if I do 100 steps, I have already a nice separation of these energy scales, and then if I go on by 500 steps, I have the spectrum looks already quite promising, and if I go on 1820 steps, then I have already a delta of 0.04. Okay, so far so good. Here I plotted the start and the end point of our variational ground state design, and since we are always staying within this Hopfield construction, the nice thing is that this Hamming distance dependent ordering is somehow preserved throughout our iterations. This basin of attraction property we can use in order to make our method a bit more computationally efficient, because instead of calculating all 2^n energies at every step, I can restrict myself onto a quite reduced set of states, which is very close in Hamming distance to the actually stored patterns. So I have to calculate at every step only order n to the power of these Hamming distance energies. Okay, we also looked at the capacity of our approach, and here I plotted how many bit string configurations arbitrary bit string configurations M I can store for a certain system size for a delta of 0.1 and different interaction terms. And non-surprisingly, that matches the upper bound for the general capacity of the Hopfield network for single 2D body interactions. And yeah, this one can easily calculate via threshold logic arguments. Okay. So let me just wrap up with a small example. So let's think about this problem. My goal is to create a superposition, a particular superposition like this, where I want the squared amplitudes to be 1/3, what would be actually a fair sampling example. And I want a logical system with single and two-body interaction. Okay, as I said, the step one would be this ground state design here. Then I have to translate that into this lattice gauge model I explained to you before, and then I have to tweak the CPs such that in the end I get the desired probability out. Okay, just a note here, in the new paper we also included the Schiefer-Wolf theory for non-perfectly degenerate ground state, which turned out to work also quite good. Okay, as a summary, I showed you how to do state preparation in this LHZ architecture, where we use polynomially many qubits for polynomial input. And if you're interested in the details, step one you can find in this paper, and step two this paper. And this is interesting for us because this LHZ architecture is interesting for implementation in various platforms, as I said already before. And with this, I want to finish and thank you for your attention. A very fast quench.
Very fast quench. So right now you're line plumb making this crossover from, from this coherent meeting that you where you freeze out and then you're no longer able to get back to the system. So you're really sampling at this point, right?
Yes, exactly.
Like the sample earlier would be helpful.
Can I sample earlier in the fully adiabatic scheme? I mean, yeah, it would be helpful, I guess, because the driver terms would be even higher there. So, yeah, I guess so. Yeah.